Hello and good time of day to all of you, my chess friends here on the Internet Chess Club. This is Grandmaster Alex Chermolinsky. Welcome to my Russian Schoolboy Live show. And today we're trying a new thing. Well, prior to that, every show that I had already for a few months, they come out twice a month, was pretty much scripted. So I had prepared material, which is not a bad thing necessarily. But I had a feeling that maybe you were too much kind of led through without giving a chance to show your initiative and point the show to the right direction. So now this is your chance. Well, I have a chat window open here, and hello David Sanders, and hello Internet Chess Club. I can see you typing. And that's how I'm gonna interact with you guys. So, anything you wanna know, any subject, opening, middle game, end game, history of chess, your favorite player, recent tournament, predictions, anything you want. Now, rules are simple, first come, first served. Well, unless if I cannot fulfill this request, then I will read it out anyway, and I'll apologize and go to the next one. Okay. All the same, I can't wait forever if you guys are not prepared. So while you're thinking of your questions, I may just start on with my backup plan. And my backup plan, as you probably expected, is the endgame. Alright, so throughout my career I was known for my love for the endgame. No, it's not necessarily a bad thing, you know, when you have one area of the game where you really enjoy yourself playing and enjoy success that your play brings. Probably it's even more important than working on patching up the holes and always thinking, okay, if I can get this one fixed, if I can learn to play against the Sicilian, or if I can get a reliable opening against d4, or if I can learn to play rook end games, then I will be. Well, it's important, of course. You can have those giant holes in your game, but all the same, there's gotta be something that you really do well, and you always wanna do it. And when you get, in your territory, then you're unstoppable. Okay, for me, it just turned out to be an area of what they call technical endgame, and particularly endgames with little material left on the board and some issues of breaking through a fortress. Now, we're starting with this game where I had white pieces against a popular Filipino-American master, Angelo Young. I don't know if he has the IM title. He certainly plays like IM. I played him many times. He's a pretty strong player. Lives in the Chicago area. Well, the game went well for me, and I was able to win a pawn, and I was kind of carrying my advantage through and came to this point. And now, all right, I played my next move, aiming for the b8 square, and looking to win the exchange. Yeah, so, well, black cannot defend this game with conventional means. Bringing that rook back to c8 doesn't really do anything. White can go knight d7, and look at the domination of the knight over the bishop. And the rook, of course, also helps to take away the e5 square. What it means that the white rook is going to come to b8 on the very next move. Okay, now if the rook does come to b8, then white stands to win a whole rook, and the game will immediately be over. Okay, guys, you do multitasking, you know, you listen to me, you watch the game I'm showing to you, and yet you work on your questions. Angelo Young is a scrappy defender, tough, practical player he is. And he found the best chance. He decided to sacrifice the exchange and eliminated dangerous pawn on a7. And also, keep the rooks on the board. Okay. Now, here is what we have. We have a complex endgame. No, I'll call it complex, not because it's very difficult to play, simply because it has more than one piece each, not counting the kings and pawns, of course. Now, any endgame of that variety can only be played correctly if you know the consequences of the exchange. Now, in this case, you know, if the rooks are traded, who's going to benefit from this? Is white going to win the game, or is it going to be a draw? There is no need to play bishop d4, right? Well, it's simple deflection there, David. All right, so that's the first question, and I would like to hear some answers. Now, most of the time, of course, when you up the exchange, you want to trade everything, because advantage of your rook over a minor piece, be it a bishop or knight. Actually, I have another example ready for you, if I have time. Well, how to break through against knight. But now we're dealing with the bishop, so do we want to trade rooks or not? What happens if in this position I play this, and black plays whatever, king h7, and then comes this move. So what is going to happen? Can white win? In order to answer this question, we really have to be familiar with typical positions of rook versus bishop with pawns on the same side of the board. It's a draw because h1 is white. No, well, the issue of h1 square being white, well, only will come up if I, by some accident, drop my rook for some pawns. And then black will be playing for a win, and then perhaps he won't be able to win because his h-pawn won't be enough to win the game. Okay, the suggestion here is that black doesn't want to trade rooks because this is a win. Now, alright, let's see how. Black is going to put that pawn on f5. And then we start a journey with the king. Clearly, the only target for white to attack is the pawn on g6. You always try to hit the base of that pawn chain. Let's just see what happens. So the king comes up, and black just sends this bishop somewhere, some random square, maybe even a1. White advances the king forward, and hits the bishop again, and comes all the way to a6. Now, I can play bishop d4 here, but I deliberately not going to raise the issue of capturing the pawn on f2, because the main job for the bishop, of course, is to control the f6 square. Alright, what next? Alright, king is already on a6. I need help. What am I going to do? Well, if I give this check, the black king obviously is not going to surrender the f7 square. He's not going to h7, no sir. He's going to come up to g7 and sit there. How does my king get in touch with that g6 pawn? Is it time for white perhaps to start using the pawns? Well, yeah, we can, of course. We can do this kind of stuff. And we can even play g4. Black's happy to trade. Then we catch that bishop and the pawn on the square. We grab that. And once again, no king h7. He's always gonna keep our king away from f7. And now what? So I go back. He waits. I check him. All right, f3, g4. I did that. See, I anticipated what you said. Operating with a little lag, about 20 seconds. So please don't get upset if I don't answer your questions immediately. Or rather, no. The other way around. If I go ahead by seemingly ignoring your question, the answer to this is that I haven't seen it yet. Because as soon as it appears, I'm gonna backtrack and come back and deal with your suggestion. All right, the king once again is not going to go to h6. Allowing the white king to come to f7 is very unhealthy for black's position. No, stays back on g8. No, I eliminated front pawns, right? h5 and f5. What do I do now? How about this idea? I drive my pawn to g5. I can do that, right? At no moment he's gonna attack it because it'll allow my king to come to f6. So he waits. And now I come rook f7. And he waits. And I come rook f6. Huh? Do you wanna take that rook? I'll take back with the king. And now I have my king in a superior position. And I'm gonna win the g6 pawn, and my pawn is already on the fifth. So that position doesn't matter. White wins. White wins. White wins if black takes on f6. But what if he doesn't? Huh? I don't think white accomplished anything. Of course, I can sit there with the king on a7, hoping that he will take, foolishly. But no, he won't. Is there any progress to be made in this situation? I don't think so. In fact, I know it's impossible because already this position and I backtrack a few moves is a theoretical draw. There is nothing to be done against this pawn on g6. Well, the problem is twofold here. Of course, black very well coordinates his defenses. All his pieces, the king, the bishop, and the pawn, are ideally positioned. Well, basically, not allowing the white king to come to the f-file. You probably figured out already that if I go around, back around this way, and I come to f4, threatening to come to g5, black will just put the bishop on f6. Okay, let's do this. Here, waits, here. Waits. King f4, bishop f6. Attack him, right? No, king f7. I can't use the same rook to keep the king cut off on the seventh and attack the bishop on f6. All right. Giving up? I agree with you. I said already, theoretical draw, not your fault. There is no solution. Now, I will mention, however, briefly, because I don't want to get into this. It's gonna take us too much time. That if in this position the white pawns are not doubled and they're all blockaded, with the pawns on f4, g3 and h4. That's a theoretical position studied. It happened in many games. I believe the first complete study of this endgame was published many years ago in Chess in the USSR magazine by famous grandmaster Ratmir Holmov, who pointed out that white can win. But in order to do this, he must decisively break through with g4. So with that pawn on h4, once again, at some moment, with the correct position of the white rook, but we're not going to this stuff today. White plays g4, and either way black takes, say he takes this way. The h-pawn goes to h5, capture, and the king takes to f5. Now, after that, black will have two connected passpawns, and they're pretty far advanced, but not supported with the king. White needs to be very careful in that situation, and but if he's careful, he's gonna stop the pawns and keep his passed pawn and win the game. All the same, that if... usually the rook has to, the bishop has to be kept from the fourth rank. It's something like this, and then here. And then once again, if the pawn on h4 breakthrough, takes, the pawn is on h4, right? Then we go f5, takes, and then the king comes in and grabs both pawns eventually. And all right, can I apply the same plan in this real position? Of course not. The breakthrough g4 doesn't do anything. He of course takes with the h-pawn, and I don't have any follow-up. The pawn remains on g6, the pawn structure remains, and white did not help his cause. Not at all. Okay. Well, this game, and many other games I played, illustrate the importance of what I preach, you know, in my Russian schoolboy videos. Already been doing it for very many years. When we talk about the endgame, we talk a lot about the endgame. Now, you may be able to calculate variations very well. I hope so. It's very important to be able to calculate variations. Your calculations in the endgame are not going to be wide, but they're going to be deep. So work on your visualization so you won't have any problems seeing those positions in your mind's eye, even if you're 10, 15, 20 moves removed from the position on the board. You also need some good knowledge of general positional principles of endgame play. In this case, well, we're applying one of them. It's good to trade pair of rooks, because then you have a pure advantage of rook versus bishop. But black also applies positional principles. He avoids bad moves such as f6 or g5, which would create holes for the white king to get through. He keeps his pawns on the light squares and complements the pawn structure with the bishop on the dark squares, therefore creating an impenetrable barrier on the path of the white king. Now, okay, there are many other standard principles of endgame play that we use. Use your king actively, put your rook behind passed pawns, advance your connected passers slowly without making holes between them, and stuff like this. Centralize your pieces, particularly knights. But even that, combined with your calculation, is not enough. Because you need specific particular knowledge of typical endgame positions. Those that happen often, such as 3-on-3, the same side of the board. Rook versus bishop. If you know them by heart, then you don't have to, first of all, you won't go wrong aiming for them, you know, if that position is not going to bring you a desired result. And secondly, when you know exactly, you know, what happens in those cases, your calculations become much shorter. You don't need to calculate till checkmate. You just calculate until you get to that familiar position. Now, in my case here, I knew that my target position shouldn't be my target position because it's a draw. Okay. I had to use some deception. Now, chess is, of course, a game of warfare. And as Art of War tells us that brute force and the most straightforward way through is not always the way to go. Sometimes you need a little bit of deception, kind of hide your intentions, because the opponent, particularly when he sits there in his fortress and he's under siege, is probably not gonna venture out of it unless he feels it's absolutely necessary. All right. So here was my plan here. I realized that I need to play g4 and recapture on g4 with one of my pieces, be it a rook or a king. And that's first step of my plan. Now, could black have stopped me from that? Perhaps he could. But he decided not to. The only way to stop me, no, actually two ways stopping me. One would be to put the rook on the fourth rank. But you immediately detect a problem with that. Right. Oh, getting rid of double pawns with the eye on the rook versus bishop endgame. Now, this attempt to stop the white plan on its tracks is obviously faulty. White now brings two rooks on the seventh rank. And that's going to be trouble. Probably the best thing black can do now under the circumstances is to go back with the rook and take a passive position on f8. And then white gets to play his g4. Okay. What about the move f5 here? That stops g4 for sure. At least in a way white wants it. Yeah, f7 would fall on that line. But if black plays f5 too soon, white will switch point of his attack to a new target, a new weakness that just appeared on black's position. And that is another pawn, different pawn. Obviously, that's the g6 pawn. Yep. You see, the combined power of two rooks is gonna make trouble for black, right? Like it did against f7. Now, in this position, black simply is not in time to protect the pawn on g6. I don't think so. I think that simply rook b6 and king h7 and then that move. That goes without saying that once you know black plays g5, actually maybe I should have stopped that. What do you think, guys? How about the move f4? And then go this on the next move. It's possible, right? He can take this defensive formation. Well, once again, we know the situation, right? Black would play f5 as soon as the rooks are traded. So now the question is, Can white do anything in this position without trading rooks? I'm looking at one thing here. I'm not sure it would exactly work out, but the plan would be to bring the king up all the way to g5. You have to be very careful because you don't want to get mated once you arrived in this square, maybe with the bishop from e7. But that's a plan. Now, blacks attempt to cover that square with h6. So off we go. This. Alright, I don't think he can do anything constructive. He has to wait. And I come up, and he has to wait, and I come up. And he does this. And now the right move probably has to be something involving the attack on the f5 pawn, because the g6 pawn is pinned. It's not an easy task, by the way. Nothing's easy in this position. Yeah, attack the pawn, but it protects it with the rook. Does not allow my king through, and now there is bishop f6 check to throw me back. So I go back there, and then he goes back. Where is the win, people? Well, the answer is that maybe there is no win. Maybe indeed black should have taken that defensive setup. But I really didn't think he would. The move f5 is very difficult to play with 4 rooks on the board. So that's the deception I had. I deliberately played this move, rook d5, because I wanted to restrict the black bishop. And make him a little uncomfortable. Because when he plays f5, he has to do it when the g7 square is clear. Once again, right? There is this, this, and that. And he doesn't have rook g7. Yeah, playing for rook h8 in that position, I don't know if that would be possible, because once I... So suppose, you know, he has this position again, right? We looked at this position. I can try to attack, but he has a simple defense by simply moving the rook away on the 7th. And the bishop will control the h8 square, regardless if his king is on h6 or not. Yeah, it's a serious issue how to break through here, but as I said, you know, like during the game, that was the only thing I was afraid of, because everything else was clear in my mind's eye. How would I answer the move bishop c3? Suppose my opponent moves the bishop out and indicates that he wants to play f5, and then he can bring the rook over to g7. First of all, I would be extremely unhappy to see this move. I would probably play something like this, just trying to embarrass his bishop a little bit, because people are probably reluctant to go to a1. But if black had the whole defensive plan already mapped out in his head, maybe he would play bishop a1. Put this there. Maybe king to h7. He's ready to go. Yeah, I don't know. Luckily, Angelo Young didn't think of that. The reason he didn't think of that, I believe, was that he knew that he would have a defensive fortress in case of a rook trade. But And there's no reason to move the pawn from f7. So once again, the same thing, you know, if he acts by old wisdom of ain't broke, don't fix it, right? Yeah, with the black rook on g7, is there a way to dominate the black bishop? I can try to harass the bishop. But the diagonal is very long, and besides, if I move one of my rooks from the 6th rank, he's going to be able to move his rook out of g7 and protect that bishop. I agree with David Sanders, you know, it's probably not possible. Okay, to the game. Oh, that was big relief when I was able to get in g4. So that concludes the first part of my plan. Alright, every time there is a change in the pawn structure in those complex endgames. Change in the pawn structure, even if you're not sure exactly what's going on. Once again, go back to the drawing board and try to figure out what happens if you trade down now. So every position, every change in the position has to be immediately followed by this very first important step in your evaluation. Look what happens if you trade. Now, I had an idea in mind. So these moves are probably not very exact, but what I was trying to do here, I didn't want to spook him. When you move your pieces back and forth and seemingly in an aimless way, it's part of this deception thing in your end game play. When you make your opponent think, all right, he doesn't know what to do. My fortress is safe. He's just shuffling pieces. And then you can catch the opponent on the wrong foot and accomplish the next step of your operation, which in my case was to trade rooks. That's why I doubled on the 7th. And I did that. Rats! He doesn't want to trade. Well, sometimes in chess games, not necessarily in the end game, not necessarily in those fortress-like positions, you can see that both players are kind of aiming for the same position. Maybe because they evaluated differently and evaluated in their favor. Now, usually the margins are like between a win and a draw, but no. Sometimes it's even wider in complex middle game positions. Both players may think, okay, I'm going to win. And they kind of hold hands and they go along the first line, you know, to arrive at this position. All right, play for f4 and g5 and double rooks on the 8th. Okay, but he abandoned the 7th rank, right? So what's going to happen when I attack the pawn on f7? Of course he goes defensively. Okay. With that rook on f8. If I try to exchange it, suppose, you know, we somehow convinced that white will do well by trading rooks. But how to do this? Suppose, you know, I put my rook back with the idea of going rook b5, preparing rook b8. Exactly at that moment, he's going to come out, and as I go to the 8th, he's going to go somewhere. Then I got to switch back to what I have on the board, and then he will have time to return to f8. There is the h file, But the H file is not very promising. Suppose I double up on the H file and I come to H7. Check, King G8. What next? The bishop controls H8. Now, a lot of endgame specialists and authors of endgame books warn the reader from advancing his pawns too soon. Obviously, there are exceptions from this. For example, king and pawn endgames with passed pawns, you know, running opposite sides of the board, you know, then you don't have no time to waste. But generally speaking, it's a good advice. At every stage of your... At every stage of this change in pawn structure, you have to look at all possibilities that your pieces can provide. I'm talking particularly of fortress-like positions, because the opponent is not bothering you with any counterplay. So you can look at this, you can imagine that, and until you exhausted those possibilities of improving your pieces, you probably indeed should not be moving your pawns. At this moment, guys, I would like to... Yeah, time to advance the pawns. I would like to look at my analysis, if I could. That'll help me. So I don't wanna confuse you. Let me open my analysis there. Okay. All right, doing good. Yeah, what did I play? I played king e4. He waits. King d5, he waits. So, there is a suggestion here to go g4 and g5, and then f5. Okay, well, good idea. I was worried about something, though. If I play g4 here, what if black plays g5? Now, it kind of goes against the grain. It goes against this main plan, which would be to keep the pawns on white squares. But how exactly I take advantage of that? Suppose I take, and I bring my king over, and it's this, and this, and that. Now I have a threat of going g6. So I assume he does that. Well, what do I do now? Well, if I play g6, opens up his king. But I don't really have any threats. And I traded off all the pawns. Besides, he can always push my king back. And then return if needed. Somehow, I'm not even sure I will be successful anymore if I get my trade in. Say goes king of eight. Now I do have some chances here, but I have to have some attack going against the pawn on f7. And if I get my king now around, try to bring the king over this way, and play check, and then come king e8, I'm afraid my g5 pawn will come under attack. First from the bishop, and then maybe eventually even from the king. attacking the spawn on f7 would be a great plan, but only if my pawn was back on g4, or better yet on g2. So that way the pawn will be safe from the black bishop, and also from the black king, because it would be too long a way to go. Once again, tricks with rook f6. Well, I don't know. I don't think I can sacrifice the exchange in this position. Perhaps it was a different position, Paul Morphy. Or David Sanders, you know, you guys. I don't know at what moment. Alright, so it's clear that the pawn has to remain on g4. See, pawns don't go back, right? So I probably have to, in this position, once again, try to engineer my plan with trading rooks. But I could only trade rooks because the move g5 in this position, he plays bishop c3. The move g5 pushed him back to g8 because of the threat g6. And if I just do this, I'm sure he's gonna come out with the rook. What is this, you know, like... I mean... It's hard, right? It's really hard to do, because you wanna trade rooks in some situations, and you can force it, force this trade, but it requires too much commitment from white. Zugzwangs, oh, I don't know, I don't see them yet, guys. I thought of this, and I also looked at the move f5. Well, that, once again, would be a great situation if I could trade rooks. But how to do this? Once again, we're dealing with the same thing. Every time I want to do this, this, and that, he's gonna come out. And I'm not ready to bear down on the f7 pawn again. When I reposition my rooks, he will hide back in f8. It's like one of those positional draws when there's just some configuration of pieces there, and the defender reacts to the attacker and just shifts, you know, his defensive position a little bit, and just holds it. Rook b5 here. Okay, suppose he moved somewhere. I got this there, and I got that. And he's got check. Didn't give me a chance to play rook b8. No, I decided that I shouldn't be doing this, and I shouldn't be moving my g pawn forward yet. I actually went back and only played g4 here. And that was smart, because now I answered g5 with king f5. By giving the opponent a chance, you know, I'm not sure he would have played g5, because from what happened in the game, king to c7, and then trade like this. I actually didn't think of that. But it's c7 is dark square, meaning that he's going to be able to give bishop e5 check at some moment. Okay, let's go back. Let's look at this position. So suppose, you know, if I went here right away, and then this and that, and he waits. And now I march, but he does this. Maybe I do this, followed by king b7. Oh, I'm not sure it's gonna work out, eh? He plays this, king b7. He's got this nasty check. And then he goes back. Sometimes, this kind of stuff usually falls into the into the area of technical difficulties. Now, well, the name assumes that it can be overcome with proper technique. So what I mean by that, you know, if you know what you want to do, you just need to find the right move sequence to do this. But so far, my analysis do not uncover this sequence. I don't see it. No, I think I did the right thing by playing this. Well, you don't necessarily, you know, push through the hardest. You know, little deception just does it. Well, he didn't have particularly useful moves. Probably more stubborn in this position in the reply to King of 4. Pardon me. Would be to give check there and then go back. Still leaving yourself with the possibility of doing this. Or perhaps then I should have moved my rook to the 5th and then played g4, g5. No, going backwards, but no, we're not in a hurry. Yeah, king to c7 without... Okay, let's try that. I was right there. I was 2 moves away. So I go up and say he waits. And I go king c7. And I want to play rook b8. Not rook d8, of course, because of the check. No, he can still do this check, right, and come back. That's one thing he can do. Another thing, since my king interferes with my rooks, perhaps he could go rook e8. Yeah. Anyway, so I played this, and I went g4. And then, look, the bishop is going to be chased away from f6. Throughout the whole endgame, my opponent felt uncomfortable moving his bishop far out. Well, not because he thought he would lose it, obviously, no, just simply being alert, you know, would allow him to keep the bishop alive. But he probably didn't want to give me some extra tempo for my rook repositioning. But in this case, as he sits this way, I finally get the idea that he doesn't really he doesn't really know what's gonna happen once the rooks are traded. Okay, so I found this. So with his bishop on g7, now I pushed either the bishop to a pinned position or the king over there. He didn't want to move the king because that way obviously I bring the other rook and I attack and I assume I win the pawn on f5. On f7. So bishop f8 was played. And now I make a simple threat to double up and win the pinned bishop. Okay, finally the 8th flank. Well, I actually thought I would win the game on the spot now. I played g5 and I got my mating net all set up. Beautiful, right? Oh no, sir. He's got bishop c3. Okay, hang on a second. Move on to my analysis here. I went rook h8. Finally, he has to move the f pawn. And now comes the most critical moment of the game. Now I get to trade a pair of rooks. All right. Bishop's under attack. What to do now? Well, the pawn is still on g6, right? So he keeps the bishop on the long diagonal. His f pawn is going to be traded for the g pawn. Right now, I gave check and I took. By the way, if I play this, that blows it. Because now, same position, right? He keeps his bishop on the long diagonal, king on g8, and I cannot come anywhere near the g6 pawn. How is it different, eh? I took. Now, f5 instead of rook h8. Let me go back. Why would f5 work here? What if he takes? This. Oh, that's deep. That's fantastic. I didn't think of that. Wow, look at this idea. Juan, thank you so much, my friend. Because on this, White's got check there. And this check. And he simply queens his g pawn. Oh, f5 never occurred to me. Well, in my defense, I tell you one thing. Well, I already knew I was winning because I visualized this whole thing, you know, with the exchange of my g pawn for his f pawn. That was exactly what I wanted, this position, because I knew White wins. And let me show you how. Attack that bishop. No, he must stay on the diagonal, right, to keep White king from f6. So he went over there. Another attack. Now switch. That's why you need the f pawn, not the g pawn. The g pawn would be useless. Now, of course, on king g7, White wins with f5. Angela Young played. Yeah, I won the game. That here we ran out of time, and the rest of the moves were not recorded. But no, it doesn't matter. The main thing is this line, right? Let's go for it. This would be the main line. Now White takes and takes. All right. Another basic position that one absolutely has to know. As you're working with your rook against the bishop. Now, when no pawns on the board, there are good corners and bad corners. The corner of the color of his bishop is the bad corner because the bishop cannot provide shelter for the king. And the opponent's king is kept in the corner like this, regardless of the position of the bishop, White should be able to win. Right now, he's threatening to attack the bishop and then give this check. It is clear that in this case the game is immediately over because you come in this way. Well, the board has extension on the 8th rank, so instead of stalemate, that's the difference, right? In a good corner, it would be stalemate, the corner opposite to the cover of the bishop. Did I overlook mate and one? Yeah, I overlooked mate and one. He couldn't even go here, mate. How did I have this position with the... Ah, doesn't matter. Thank you for correction. But the point is, no, it's rather accidental. And if... All right, so suppose... Let me improvise this. Of course, I'm not gonna do this, but suppose I play some move and the bishop comes here, and or rather, no, hang on a second. So I play this there, and then I do, oh boy, you know, like I went the wrong way. So he's happy now. He attacks, and I come here, and he takes, and I take. There was no mate from h2, right? I still win here because I have this threat. The only way for him to try to defend is to keep the bishop behind my king. Because if the bishop goes anywhere else, guys, here, I can always attack it with the tempo and then come to the h-file. Of course, blundering checkmate and one is very instructive. It's maybe that's the most important thing you learn, you know, that you may miss checkmate and one and still win the game. Now, okay, so let me run it down for you. It's simple. Tal won an endgame like this once. You harass that bishop and make the bishop come out. As soon as the bishop comes to the sixth, well, you can just simply drop your rook down. Because when he tries to escape, then you pin and win that bishop. So the sixth rank is not good. It means there are no more squares. All this diagonal, anywhere it goes, the rook is gonna attack it and then it's gonna go over. Maybe sometimes with a little delay like this. Don't get too excited. Don't play rook h4. Show your patience. Attack it again. Now you want that. Attack it again. And now you got it. And I'll play your little waiting move. So it's a win. Well, this is how the game ended. Not exactly in this, but something similar. I actually didn't even have to lose my pawn. Well, multi-stage plan. So in the beginning of this whole thing, after the introductory moves, I needed to play g4 and exchange my my double pawn for his h5 pawn. I needed to have gnf versus gnf. Now, Angela Yang didn't sense the urgency of trying to put his pawn on f5 and then the rook on g7, which would be the toughest defensive formation. So he relied on his basic knowledge of the 3-on-3, he only planned to play f5 after a pair of rooks get traded. So I was able to do this. And then there was one interesting line I forgot to show you. Yeah. Okay, all this. I actually expected... I didn't expect them to try to avoid the rook trade. I thought he was gonna take. And what would be the winning plan then? No, well, it's similar, right? Here, there. But not to play f5. Because after f5, that it gives black king some opening there to attack the g5 pawn. Now, as you stop the opponent from playing f5, you go around. Okay, let's play one accurate move. Stop bishop c1. Go around and aim for the e8 square and then win the pawn on f7. Anytime he plays f5, you know, you go on high alert because now the target has disappeared. You cannot make g6 into a target. You must do as I did in the game. And then decide the game by bringing your king up like this, and exactly like in the game, switching over to the g-file. Alright. First deception, The opponent gives you a little opening, and then you threw the breach in the wall, and then brutal execution. Well, that's what basically endgame is about. You know, you combine your patience in the initial stages with the resolute and, well, as I said, brutal, merciless action, you know, when you finally throw. They say that endgame technique is largely mental. That's the third part, or the fourth part. So once again, calculation, knowledge of basic endgame rules, and knowledge of basic positions, your target positions. And then comes the mental part. You have to be very patient and just get it right. You know, like this. Obviously, what goes around comes around. So, basically, what can I say? For every time you're on the attacking side of this, or maybe for every two times you're on the attacking side, it's going to come one day when you're going to have to defend. And that's when we're going to experience this whole thing only from the other side. But such is life, and those half points you gain because of your good end game play, and those half points your opponent loses if he's not equipped for this kind of play, it's gonna make up to a lot of difference in the final standings and on your leaderboard and your list of prize winners. All right, guys. Now, I want to spend a few minutes talking to you, because now I had I don't know how many people are following me, but thing is, we've been talking about how to improve this show, and, well, we're going to still give you another chance and more chances as far as becoming more active participants. The show is going to be scheduled ahead of the time. We'll make sure of that. The next one is actually next week, a week from now, Thursday, same time, 6 o'clock ICC. 5 o'clock ICC. It will end at 6 o'clock. Yeah. What you can do and what you should be doing is to prepare your questions and well, contact administrators there on the Internet Chess Club with your questions. So that way you will have time to work on your questions. I will have a little bit of time to prepare. Now, probably need a few hours at least. Better get your questions ready the day before. And that way, you know, you can follow the show live and interact and enjoy basically fruits of your work, you know, together with me. Eventually, maybe in the future, you know, like we can even make it better. I could invite the winner of the contest with his question or questions to come live via Skype and talk and discuss it with me. And, wouldn't that be fun? I really urge you guys to do this because, we must go along with the times, right? It's all about, everything has to be interactive. Interactive TV, interactive shows, and, whatever, you know. That's how it is. And, I'm not in danger of running out of ideas and subjects for my shows. I think this would be more fun. So please, get to work. You have 7 days now to figure out what you want. And let me know. And I will choose the most interesting questions. Well, there may be more than one answer, by the way, during the show. It's an hour-long show. All right, guys. So I'll be waiting for your messages. And thank you for staying with me. That was Grandmaster Aleks Chermolinskiy. with his whatever Russian schoolboy knows. Russian schoolboy knows endgames like this by heart, you can tell. It wasn't empty talk, you know. I conducted my plan through and through. So every Russian schoolboy knows an interactive format, live shows here on the Internet Chess Club. I'll see you guys next week. Well, good luck. Well, yeah, I know I'm going to do this. I don't know, eventually, you know, I'm just going to make you do this one way or another. You will see. Okay, see you next week, guys. Bye. No king h7. He's always going to keep our king away from f7. And now what? So I go back. He waits. I check him. Alright, f3, g4, I did that. See, I anticipated what you said. Operating with a little lag, about 20 seconds. So please don't get upset if I don't answer your questions immediately. Or rather, no. The other way around. If I go ahead by seemingly ignoring your question. The answer to this is that I haven't seen it yet. Because as soon as it appears, I'm going to backtrack and come back and deal with your suggestion. All right, the king once again is not going to go to h6. Allowing the white king to come to f7 is very unhealthy for black's position. No, stays back on g8. No, I eliminated front pawns, right? h5 and f5. What do I do now? How about this idea? I drive my pawn to g5. I can do that, right? At no moment he's going to attack it because it'll allow my king to come to f6. So he waits. And now I come rook f7. And he waits. And I come rook f6. Huh? Do you want to take that rook? I'll take back with the king. And now I have my king in a superior position. And I'm going to win the g6 pawn. And my pawn is already on the fifth. So that position doesn't matter. White wins. White wins if black takes on f6. But what if he doesn't? Huh? I don't think white accomplished anything. Of course, I can sit there with the king on a7, hoping that he will take, foolishly. But no, he won't. Is there any progress to be made in this situation? I don't think so. In fact, I know it's impossible, because already this position, and I backtrack a few moves, is a theoretical draw. There is nothing to be done against this pawn on g6. Well, the problem is twofold here. Of course, black very well coordinates his defenses. All his pieces, the king, the bishop, and the pawn, are ideally positioned. Or basically not allowing the white king to come to the f-file. You probably figured out already that if I go around, back around this way, and I come to f4, threatening to come to g5, black will just put the bishop on f6. Okay, let's do this. Here, waits, here. Waits. King f4, bishop f6. Attack him, right? No, king f7. I can't use the same rook to keep the king cut off on the 7th and attack the bishop on f6. Alright. Giving up? I agree with you. I said already, theoretical draw, not your fault. There is no solution. Now, I will mention, however briefly, because I don't want to get into this. It's gonna take us too much time. That if in this position, the white pawns are not doubled, and they're all blockaded, with the pawns on f4, g3, and h4. That's a theoretical position studied. That happened in many games. I believe the first complete study of this endgame was published many years ago in Chess in the USSR magazine by famous grandmaster Ratmir Holmov, who pointed out that white can win. But in order to do this, he must decisively break through with g4. So with that pawn on h4, once again, at some moment, with the correct position of the white rook, but we're not going to this stuff today. White plays g4, and either way black takes, say he takes this way. The h-pawn goes to h5, capture, and the king takes to f5. Now, after that, black will have two connected passed pawns, and they're pretty far advanced, but not supported with the king. White needs to be very careful in that situation, but if he's careful, he's gonna stop the pawns and keep his passed pawn and win the game. All the same, that if... usually the bishop has to be kept from the fourth rank. It's something like this, and then here. And then once again, if the pawn on h4 breakthrough, takes, the pawn is on h4, right? Then we go f5, takes, and then the king comes in and grabs both pawns eventually. And all right, can I apply the same plan in this real position? No, of course not. The breakthrough g4 doesn't do anything. He, of course, takes with the h-pawn, and I don't have any follow-up. The pawn remains on g6, the pawn structure remains, and white did not help his cause. Not at all. Okay. Well, this game, and many other games I played, illustrate the importance of what I preach, you know, in my Russian schoolboy videos. Already been doing it for very many years. When we talk about the endgame, we talk a lot about the endgame. Now, you may be able to calculate variations very well. I hope so. It's very important to be able to calculate variations. Your calculations in the endgame are not going to be wide, but they're going to be deep. So work on your visualization so you won't have any problems seeing those positions in your mind's eye, even if you're 10, 15, 20 moves removed from the position on the board. You also need some good knowledge of general positional principles of endgame play. In this case, well, we're applying one of them. It's good to trade pair of rooks, because then you have a pure advantage of rook versus bishop. But black also applies positional principles. He avoids bad moves such as f6 or g5, which would create holes for the white king to get through. He keeps his pawns on the light squares and complements the pawn structure with the bishop on the dark squares, therefore creating an impenetrable barrier on the path of the white king. Now, okay, there are many other standard principles of endgame play that we use. Use your king actively, put your rook behind passed pawns, advance your connected passers slowly, without making holes between them, and stuff like this. Centralize your pieces, particularly knights. But even that, combined with your calculation, is not enough. Because you need specific particular knowledge of typical endgame positions, those that happen often, such as 3-on-3, the same side of the board, rook versus bishop. If you know them by heart, then you don't have to, first of all, you won't go wrong aiming for them, you know, if that position is not going to bring you a desired result. And secondly, when you know exactly, you know, what happens in those cases, your calculations become much shorter. You don't need to calculate till checkmate. You just calculate until you get to that familiar position. Now, in my case here, I knew that my target position is shouldn't be my target position because it's a draw. Okay. I had to use some deception. Now, chess is, of course, a game of warfare. And as Art of War tells us that brute force and the most straightforward way through is not always the way to go. Sometimes you need a little bit of deception, kind of hide your intentions, because the opponent, particularly when he sits there in his fortress and he's under siege, is probably not gonna venture out of it unless he feels it's absolutely necessary. All right, so here was my plan here. I realized that I need to play g4 and recapture on g4 with one of my pieces, be it a rook or a king. And that's first step of my plan. Now, could black have stopped me from that? Perhaps he could. Sometimes, this kind of stuff usually falls into the area of technical difficulties. Now, the name assumes that it can be overcome with proper technique. So what I mean by that, you know, if you know what you want to do, you just need to find the right move sequence to do this. But so far, my analysis do not uncover this sequence. I don't see it. No, I think I did the right thing by playing this. Well, you don't necessarily, you know, push through the hardest. You know, little deception just does it. Well, he didn't have particularly useful moves. Probably more stubborn in this position in reply to king g4. Pardon me. Would be to give check there and then go back. Still leaving yourself with the possibility of doing this. Or perhaps then I should have moved my rook to the fifth and then played g4, g5. Well, going backwards, but no, we're not in a hurry. Yeah, king to c7 without... Okay, let's try that. I was right there. I was 2 moves away. So I go up and say he waits. And I go king c7. And I want to play rook b8. Not rook d8, of course, because of the check. No, he can still do this check, right, and come back. That's one thing he can do. Another thing, since my king interferes with my rooks, perhaps he could go rook a8. Yeah. Anyway, so I played this, and I went g4. And then, look, The bishop is going to be chased away from f6. Throughout the whole endgame, my opponent felt uncomfortable moving his bishop far out. Well, not because he thought he would lose it, obviously, no, just simply being alert, you know, would allow him to keep the bishop alive. But he probably didn't want to give me some extra tempo for my rook repositioning. But in this case, as he sits this way, I finally get the idea that he doesn't really he doesn't really know what's going to happen once the rooks are traded. Okay, so I found this. So with his bishop on g7, now I pushed it either the bishop to a pinned position or the king over there. He didn't want to move the king because that way, obviously, I bring the other rook and I attack and I assume I win the pawn on f5. On f7. So bishop f8 was played. And now I make a simple threat to double up and win the pinned bishop. Okay, finally the 8th flank. Well, I actually thought I would win the game on the spot now. I played g5 and I got my mate in that all set up. Beautiful, right? Well, no, sir. He's got bishop c3. Okay, hang on a second. Move on to my analysis here. I went rook h8. Finally, he has to move the f pawn. And now comes the most critical moment of the game. Now I get to trade a pair of rooks. All right. Bishop's under attack. What to do now? Well, the pawn is still on g6, right? So, he keeps the bishop on the long diagonal. His f-pawn is going to be traded for the g-pawn. Right now. I gave check and I took. By the way, if I play this, that blows it. Because now, same position, right? He keeps his bishop on the long diagonal, king on g8, and I cannot come anywhere near the g6 pawn. How is it different, eh? Knight took. Now, f5 instead of rook h8. Let me go back. Why would f5 work here? What if he takes? This. Oh, that's deep. That's fantastic. I didn't think of that. Wow, look at this idea. Juan, thank you so much, my friend. Because on this, white's got check there. And this check. And it simply queens his g-pawn. Oh, f5 never occurred to me. Well, in my defense, I tell you one thing. Well, I already knew I was winning. Because I visualized this whole thing, you know, with the exchange of my g-pawn for his f-pawn. That was exactly what I wanted, this position. Because I knew white wins. And let me show you how. Attack that bishop. No, he must stay on the diagonal, right, to keep the white king from f6. So he went over there. Another attack. Now switch. That's why you need the F pawn, not the G pawn. The G pawn would be useless. Now, of course, on King G7, white wins with F5. Angela Young played yeah, I won the game. That here we ran out of time, and the rest of the moves were not recorded. But no, it doesn't matter. The main thing is this line, right? Let's go for it. This would be the main line. Now white takes and takes. All right. Another basic position that one absolutely has to know. As you're working with your rook against the bishop. Now, when no pawns on the board, there are good corners and bad corners. The corner of the color of his bishop is the bad corner, because the bishop cannot provide shelter for the king. And the opponent's king is kept in the corner like this, regardless of the position of the bishop, white should be able to win. Right now, he's threatening to attack the bishop and then give this check. It is clear that in this case the game is immediately over. Because you come in this way. Well, the board has extension on the 8th rank, so instead of stalemate, that's the difference, right? In a good corner it would be stalemate. The corner opposite to the cover of the bishop. Did I overlook mate and one? Yeah, I overlooked mate and one. He couldn't even go here, mate. How did I have this position with the... Ah, doesn't matter. Thank you for correction. But the point is, no, it's rather accidental. And if... All right, so suppose... Let me improvise this. Of course, I'm not gonna do this, but suppose I play some move and the bishop comes here. And, or rather, no, hang on a second. So I play this, there, and then I do, oh, well, boy, you know, like, I went the wrong way. So he's happy now, he attacks. And I come here. And he takes, and I take. There was no mate from h2, right? I still win here because I have this threat. The only way for him to try to defend is to keep the bishop behind my king. Because if the bishop goes anywhere else, guys, here, I can always attack it with the tempo and then come to the h-file. Of course, blundering checkmate and one is very instructive. It's maybe... Maybe that's the most important thing you learn, you know, that you may miss checkmate and one and still win the game. Now, okay, so let me run it down for you. It's simple. Tal won an endgame like this once. You harassed that bishop. All right, play for f4 and g5 and double rooks on the 8th. Okay, but he abandoned the 7th rank, right? So what's gonna happen when I attack the pawn on f7? Of course he goes defensively. Okay. With that rook on f8. If I try to exchange it, suppose you know we somehow convinced that white We'll do well by trading rooks, but how to do this? Suppose, you know, I put my rook back with the idea of going rook b5, preparing rook b8. Exactly at that moment he's gonna come out, and as I go to the 8th, he's gonna go somewhere. Then I gotta switch back to what I have on the board, and then he will have time to return to f8. There is the h file, but the h file is not very promising. Suppose I double up on the h file and I come to h7. Check, king g8. What next? The bishop controls h8. Now, a lot of endgame specialists and authors of endgame books warn the reader from advancing his pawns too soon. Obviously, there are exceptions from this. For example, king and pawn endgames with passed pawns, you know, running opposite sides of the board, you know, then you don't have no time to waste. But generally speaking, it's a good advice. At every stage of your... at every stage of this change in pawn structure, you have to look at all possibilities that your pieces can provide. I'm talking particularly of fortress-like positions, because the opponent is not bothering you with any counterplay. So you can look at this, you can imagine that, and until you exhausted those possibilities of improving your pieces, you probably indeed should not be moving your pawns. At this moment, guys, I would like to... Yeah, time to advance the pawns. I would like to look at my analysis, if I could. That'll help me. So I don't wanna confuse you. Let me open my analysis there. Okay. All right, doing good. Yeah, I played. What did I play? I played king e4. He waits. King d5, he waits. So, there is a suggestion here to go g4 and g5, and then f5. Okay, well, good idea. I was worried about something, though. If I play g4 here, what if black plays g5? Now, it kind of goes against the grain. It goes against this main plan, which would be to keep the pawns on white squares. But how exactly I take advantage of that? Suppose I take, and I bring my king over, and it's this, and this, and that. Now I have a threat of going g6. So I assume he does that. Well, what do I do now? Well, if I play g6, opens up his king. But I don't really have any threats, and I traded off all the pawns. Besides, he can always push my king back, and then return if needed. Somehow... I'm not even sure I will be successful anymore if I get my trade in. Say goes king of eight. Now, I do have some chances here, but I have to have some attack going against the pawn on f7. And if I get my king now around, try to bring the king over this way and play check, and then come king e8. I'm afraid my g5 pawn will come under attack. First from the bishop, and then maybe eventually even from the king. Yeah, attacking the pawn on f7 would be a great plan, but only if my pawn was back on g4, or better yet on g2. So that way the pawn will be safe from the black bishop, and also from the black king, because it would be too long a way to go. Once again, tricks with rook f6. Well, I don't know. I don't think I can sacrifice the exchange in this position. Perhaps it was a different position, Paul Morphy. Or David Sanders, you guys. I don't know at what moment. All right, so it's clear that the pawn has to remain on g4. See, pawns don't go back, right? So I probably have to, in this position, once again, try to engineer my plan with trading rooks. But I could only trade rooks because the move g5 in this position, he plays bishop c3. The move g5 pushed him back to g8 because of the threat g6. And if I just do this, I'm sure he's gonna come out with the rook. What is this, I mean, it's hard, right? It's really hard to do because you wanna trade rooks in some situations, and you can force it, force this trade, but it required too much commitment from white. Zugzwangs. Oh, I don't know. I don't see them yet, guys. I thought of this, and I also looked at the move f5. Well, that once again would be a great situation if I could trade rooks. But how to do this? Once again, we're dealing with the same thing. Every time I wanna do this, and that, he's gonna come out. And I'm not ready to bear down on the f7 pawn again. When I reposition my rooks, he will hide back on f8. It's like one of those positional draws when there's just some configuration of pieces there, and the defender reacts to the attacker and just shifts, his defensive position a little bit and just holds it. Rook b5 here. Okay, suppose he moved somewhere. I got this there, and I got that. He's got check. Didn't give me a chance to play rook b8. No, I decided that I shouldn't be doing this, and I shouldn't be moving my g pawn forward yet. I actually went back and only played g4 here. And that was smart, because now I answer g5 with king f5. By giving opponent a chance, I'm not sure he would have played g5, because from what happened in the game, Oh, king to c7, and then trade like this. I actually didn't think of that. But the c7 is dark square, meaning that he's going to be able to give bishop e5 check at some moment. Okay, let's go back. Let's look at this position. So suppose, if I went here right away, and then this and that, and he waits. And now I march, but he does this. Maybe I do this. followed by king b7. Oh, I'm not sure it's gonna work out, eh? He plays this, king b7. He's got this nasty check. And then he goes back. But he decided not to. The only way to stop me, no, actually two ways stopping me. One would be to put the rook on the fourth rank. But you immediately detect a problem with that. Right. Oh, getting rid of double pawns with the eye on the rook versus bishop endgame. Now, this attempt to stop white plan on its tracks is obviously faulty. White now brings two rooks on the seventh rank. And that's going to be trouble. Probably the best thing black can do now under the circumstances is to go back with the rook and take a passive position on f8. And then white gets to play his g4. Okay. What about the move f5 here? That stops g4 for sure. At least in a way white wants it. Yeah, f7 would fall on that line. But if black plays f5 too soon, white will switch point of his attack to a new target, a new weakness that just appeared on black's position. And that is another pawn, different pawn. Obviously, that's the g6 pawn. Yep. You see, the combined power of two rooks, it's gonna make trouble for black, right? Like it did against f7. Now, in this position, black simply is not in time to protect the pawn on g6. I don't think so. I think that simply rook b6 and king h7, and then that move. That goes without saying that. Once you know black plays g5. Actually, maybe I should have stopped that. Huh? What do you think, guys? How about the move f4? And then go this on the next move. It's possible, right? He can take this defensive formation. Well, once again, we know the situation, right? Black would play f5 as soon as the rooks are traded. So now the question is, can white do anything in this position without trading rooks? I'm looking at one thing here. I'm not sure it would exactly work out, but the plan would be to bring the king up all the way to g5. You have to be very careful because you don't want to get mated once you arrived in this square, maybe with the bishop from a7. But that's a plan. Now, black's attempt to cover that square with h6. So here we go. This. All right, I don't think he can do anything constructive. He has to wait. And I come up, and he has to wait, and I come up. And he does this. And now the right move probably has to be something involving the attack on the f5 pawn, because the g6 pawn is pinned. It's not an easy task, by the way. Nothing's easy in this position. Yeah, attack the spawn when it protects it with the rook. Does not allow my king through, and now there is bishop f6 check to throw me back. So I go back there, and then he goes back. Where is the win, people? Well, the answer is that maybe there is no win. Maybe indeed Black should have taken that defensive setup. But I really didn't think he would. The move f5 is very difficult to play with four rooks on the board, so that's the deception I had. I deliberately played this move, rook d5, because I wanted to restrict the black bishop and make him a little uncomfortable. Because when he plays f5, he has to do it when the g7 square is clear. Once again, right? There is this, this, and that. And he doesn't have rook g7. Yeah, playing for rook h8 in that position, I don't know if that would be possible, because once I... So suppose, you know, he has this position again, right? We looked at this position. I can try to attack, but he has a simple defense by simply moving the rook away on the 7th. And the bishop will control the h8 square. Regardless if his king is on h6 or not. Yes, the serious issue how to break through here. But as I said, you know, like during the game, that was the only thing I was afraid of, because everything else was clear in my mind's eye. How would I answer the move bishop c3? Suppose my opponent moves the bishop out and indicates that he wants to play f5, and then he can bring the rook over to g7. First of all, I would be extremely unhappy to see this move. I would probably play something like this, just trying to embarrass his bishop a little bit, because people are probably reluctant to go to a1. But if Black had the whole defensive plan already mapped out in his head, maybe he would play bishop a1. Put this there. Maybe king to h7. He's ready to go. Yeah, I don't know. Luckily, Angelo Young didn't think of that. The reason he didn't think of that, I believe, was that he knew that he would have a defensive fortress in case of a rook trade. And there's no reason to move the pawn from f7. So once again, the same thing, you know, if he acts by old wisdom of ain't broke, don't fix it, right? Yeah, with the black rook on g7, is there a way to dominate the black bishop? I can try to harass the bishop. But the diagonal is very long, and besides, if I move one of my rooks from the 6th rank, he's going to be able to move his rook out of g7 and protect the bishop. I agree with David Sanders, you know, it's probably not possible. Okay, to the game. Oh, that was a big relief when I was able to get in g4. So that concludes the first part of my plan. Alright, every time there is a change in the pawn structure in those complex endgames. Change in the pawn structure, even if you're not sure exactly what's going on. Once again, go back to the drawing board and try to figure out what happens if you trade down now. So every position, every change in the position has to be immediately followed by this very first important step in your evaluation. Look what happens if you trade. Now, I had an idea in mind. So these moves are probably not very exact, but what I was trying to do here, I didn't want to spook him. When you move your pieces back and forth and seemingly in an aimless way, it's part of this deception thing in your endgame play. When you make your opponent think, all right, he doesn't know what to do, my fortress is safe, he's just shuffling pieces. And then you can catch the opponent on the wrong foot and accomplish the next step of your operation, which in my case was to trade rooks. That's why I doubled on the 7th. And I did that. Rats! He doesn't want to trade. Well, sometimes in chess games, not necessarily in the endgame, not necessarily in those fortress-like positions, you can see that both players are kind of aiming for the same position. Maybe because they evaluated differently and evaluated in their favor. Now, usually the margins are like between a win and a draw, but no. Sometimes it's even wider in complex middle game positions. Both players may think, okay, I'm going to win. And they kind of hold hands and they go along the first line, you know, to arrive at this position. Hello and good time of day to all you my chess friends here on the Internet Chess Club. This is Grandmaster Alex Chermolinsky. Welcome to my Russian Schoolboy live show. And today we're trying a new thing. Well, prior to that, every show that I had already for a few months, they come out twice a month, was pretty much scripted. So I had prepared material, which is not a bad thing necessarily. But I had a feeling that maybe you were too much kind of led through without giving a chance to show your initiative and point the show to the right direction. So now this is your chance. Well, I have a chat window open here. And hello, David Sanders, and hello, Internet Chess Club. I can see you typing. And that's how I'm gonna interact with you guys. So, anything you wanna know, any subject, opening, middle game, end game, history of chess, your favorite player, recent tournament, predictions, anything you want. Now, rules are simple. First come, first served. Well, unless if I cannot fulfill this request, then I will read it out anyway, and I'll apologize and go to the next one. Okay. All the same, I can't wait forever if you guys are not prepared. So while you're thinking of your of your questions, I may just start on with my backup plan. And my backup plan, as you probably expected, is the endgame. Alright, so throughout my career I was known for my love for the endgame. And, no, it's not necessarily a bad thing, you know, when you have one area of the game where you really enjoy yourself playing and enjoy success that your play brings. Probably it's even more important than working on patching up the holes and always thinking, okay, if I can get this one fixed, if I can learn to play against the Sicilian, or if I can get a reliable opening against D4, or if I can learn to play rook end games, then I will be. Oh, well, it's important, of course. You can have those giant holes in your game, but all the same, there's gotta be something that you really do well, and you always want to do it. And when you get, you know, in your territory, then you're unstoppable. Okay, for me, it just turned out to be an area of what they call technical endgame, and particularly endgames with little material left on the board, and some issues of breaking through a fortress. Now, we're starting with this game where I had white pieces against the popular Filipino-American master, Angelo Young. I don't know if he has the IM title. He certainly plays like IM. I played him many times. He's a pretty strong player. Lives in the Chicago area. Well, the game went well for me, and I was able to win a pawn, and I was kind of carrying my advantage through and came to this point. And now, alright, I played my next move, aiming for the b8 square, and looking to win the exchange. Yeah, so, well, black cannot defend this game with conventional means. Bringing that rook back to c8 doesn't really do anything. White can go knight d7, and look at the domination of the knight over the bishop. And the rook, of course, also helps to take away the e5 square. What it means? It means that the white rook is going to come to b8 on the very next move. Okay, now if the rook does come to b8, then white stands to win a whole rook, and the game will immediately be over. Okay, guys, you do multitasking, you know, you listen to me, you watch the game I'm showing to you, and yet you work on your questions. Angelo Young is a scrappy defender, tough, practical player he is, and he found the best chance. He decided to sacrifice the exchange and eliminated dangerous pawn on a7, and also keep the rooks on the board. Okay. Now, here is what we have. We have a complex endgame. No, I'll call it complex, not because it's very difficult to play, simply because it has more than one piece each, not counting the kings and pawns, of course. Now, any endgame of that variety can only be played correctly if you know the consequences of the exchange. Now, in this case, you know, if the rooks are traded, who's going to benefit from this? Is white going to win the game, or is it going to be a draw? There is no need to play bishop d4, right? Well, it's simple deflection there, David. Alright, so that's the first question, and I would like to hear some answers. Now, most of the time, of course, when you up the exchange, you want to trade everything, because advantage of your rook over a minor piece, be it a bishop or knight. Actually, I have another example ready for you, if I have time, or how to break through against knight. But now we're dealing with the bishop, so do we want to trade rooks or not? What happens if in this position I play this, and black plays whatever, king h7. And then comes this move. So what is going to happen? Can white win? In order to answer this question, we really have to be familiar with typical positions of rook versus bishop with pawns on the same side of the board. It's a draw because h1 is white. Now, well, the issue of h1 square being white, well, only will come up if I, by some accident, drop my rook for some pawns. And then black will be playing for a win, and then perhaps he won't be able to win because his h-pawn won't be enough to win the game. Okay, the suggestion here is that black doesn't want to trade rooks because this is a win. Now, alright, let's see how. Black is going to put that pawn on f5. And then we start a journey with the king. Clearly, the only target for white to attack is the pawn on g6. You always try to hit the base of that pawn chain. Let's just see what happens. So the king comes up and black just sends this bishop somewhere, some random square, maybe even a1. White advances the king forward and hits the bishop again and comes all the way to a6. Now, I can play bishop d4 here, but I deliberately not going to raise the issue of capturing the pawn on f2, because the main job for the bishop, of course, is to control the f6 square. Alright. What next? Alright, king is already on a6. I need help. What am I gonna do? Well, if I give this check, the black king obviously is not gonna surrender the f7 square. He's not going to h7, no sir. He's gonna come up to g7 and sit there. How does my king get in touch with that g6 pawn? Is it time for white perhaps to start using the pawns? Well, yeah, we can, of course. We can do this kind of stuff. And we can even play g4. Black's happy to trade. Then we catch that bishop on the pawn on the square. We grab that. And once again,